quite a special situation because she's a medical professor. She's not a fisheries or ocean person, but she's also a real academic. It's not just about her own discipline. She looks across the board. And she's my neighbor and friend for many years. We lived just door to door like this for 12 years or so. So it's quite, I'm happy just to be here. I hope you guys have read her bio. I'm not going to read that. Those of you who haven't, please go do that. It's an amazing, amazing career. You just can't imagine. Let's see. 335 original articles, okay? Original, huh? Not book chapters and so on. 12 books and all sorts of things. As for the honors and the awards, I cannot start reading them now. It's gonna blow your mind away. So please, Judy, come over. Let us learn from your 40 years plus experience as an academic. Okay, should I say more? One more thing? When she started medical school, there were three women in her class of about 70, if I remember well. So you can imagine, there are more interesting things you will learn here. The world has moved, actually.
It's changed.
Yes, absolutely. Good. All right.
Thanks, Rasheed and I are neighbors, and so we talk across the backyard and things. And I told him about going to Japan a year and a half ago, and then I gave a talk about career development. He said, oh, what did you do? And it was kind of like I thought, you know, this might apply to other areas. So I apologize that it will be from a medical, pediatric, genetic point of view. But I don't think this is available anyplace. It's you're supposed to pick it up along the way. And of course, everybody has challenges picking it up along the way. So I'm a medical, clinical, genetic pediatrician. And what that means is I take all these wonderful new things that are happening in genetics and apply them to patients. So you have to learn to talk in lay language, which is also a wonderful challenge. I've been interested in from the very beginning in clinical, that is, what happens with patients, not trials, but like what happens over their lifetime. And as you probably know, genetic disorders are really rare, so you have to accumulate a set of patients to find out. But I also have always been interested in birth defects, congenital anomalies, what goes wrong during pregnancy. And although in developmental biology this has become a really important area, it didn't used to be. So I was kind of there when they were starting to make various kinds of transitions. But I'm also interested in the things that are non-traditional, epigenetics, mosaicism, because we see that in patients. It explains why they've got their problems. Now I think it's worth saying that I was in charge of training people, so those of you who are in training, in two situations, one for almost 10 years in Seattle at the University of Washington, and one for 10 years here in the clinical genetics unit that's at the Children's Hospital. And then I became head of pediatrics. And let me tell you, you learn a lot about administration and how the university works and all of the sort of pathways, which is what I really want to tell you about. And then I was still a professor when mandatory retirement was in place. And so I had mandatory retirement. But that was also an incredibly interesting experience. Now, in terms of the whole spectrum of an academic career, I'll tell you about that. They usually, I'll jump ahead in my story, they usually talk about, you know, the career as going down. No way. I have had much more fun since retirement. So there are really changing demographics. And for all of you, you should think in terms of how many opportunities for change you will have. When I was born, my life expectancy was 59. I've been on borrowed time for quite a while. And I think the real point is that it's going to change some more. I mean, they say the young people here will live to 100. Maybe, but the real point is, it's not like it used to be. And people used to retire at 60 and have a heart attack. So in terms of reflecting on a work life, about a third of your life is getting educated. About a third, kind of, is working your career. and about a third are all kinds of new options that have opened up. And again, the reason I didn't mention that is that you don't think about it when you're training. You don't think about it when you leave your career. But you really should start thinking about it when you're about 55. Anyhow, I think people like me are now going to end up being pioneers because of all the amazing new opportunities that really present themselves. At any rate, when I thought about this talk I was to give in Japan, I thought, you know, it's not a third, a third, a third. It's your work life and what's going on during that. And once you kind of get past a regular university degree, you're training for whatever you want to become. And there are all different routes and many ways to do it. But I judge that you train for about 10 years. And I will say some things about what you need to do during that time. Then you spend about 10 years establishing yourself, getting known in your discipline, meeting people, working for your institutions. And then you spend about 10 years kind of engaged, doing your cool work, working with a community of all kinds, UBC and the greater community, institutions of all kinds. And you learn things from one institution that you take to another. And so being involved in many things actually helps all dimensions. And then finally, kind of, you're at the stage where maybe you think about being an administrator, you're definitely a mentor, you take on complex problems because you get the big picture. And it's your opportunity to really innovate because by then, theoretically, you know your field and you know what can be done and what can't be done. And then I think there are 10 years where you're winding down, where you're training your successors, where you're shifting gears, you're maybe not getting quite as many papers and grants, you're pursuing, you're getting ready to pursue your heart's desire. And one of the interesting things we in Maritai are doing is saying, okay, once you become, quote, retired, how many more times do you change what you do? So, when I, sometimes along the way, somebody told me you change your career 10 times. And some things change at the same time. But truly, it's at least 10 times. So you're a student, a trainee, you're a house officer, a postdoc, you're working on degrees, you become an instructor. If you're in the academic scene, you're an instructor, assistant professor, associate professor, full professor. In the meanwhile, you're an author and a reviewer and an editor. And you're a researcher writing grants and you get to be asked to review them. Sometimes you get on granting councils, on committees that make really important decisions about the future. You get to be on all kinds of advisory boards if you're engaged. And maybe you'll become the chief or the chair or the head of a research unit, which then gives you all this kind of horrible administrative stuff that has to be done and has to be done well. And then, that's not to mention, in my case, a wife, a mother, a daughter, a grandmother, a household executive, and being engaged in all kinds of school stuff and community stuff. And it's really fun. So what I urge you to do is be sure to think about all of the ways you want to be engaged. Now, here's the good advice. Learn how the system works. Who do you report to? In other words, if you're a trainee, you've got somebody that's in charge of you, and there's somebody in charge of them. So what's this org chart, the organizational chart? How does it work? And how does it work for different things? How does it work for research? Well, you have to go through the VP research for research. How does it work for education? You go through the provost. If you want something new, you have to go through Senate. Learn how the system works, either in your department or your school or the bigger organization. Learn what resources are available. You'd just be amazed what's available on this campus. There are all kinds of special additional things through Peter Wall, through Green College, through your discipline, through science. And you want to know what's there because you want to take advantage of it. So don't just sit around and wait. You know, there are a lot of it's on the web, but talk to your buddies, your friends, and everybody about what's out there to take advantage of. So what additional experiences as a trainee do you want? Can you go into business? Can you have a rotation in another university? We're close to you, Vic. They've got fisheries. Is it worth going over there? So think about exchanges, because exchanges between countries are fantastic, and they give you the opportunity to learn a whole different system. So there are different expectations at different times in your training, in terms of service, in terms of the number of years, and in you need to know those. So there's a whole bunch of unwritten rules, and I can tell you they're unwritten. That's part of why I put this together. So there are all sorts of organizations for trainees from which you learn tons. You learn who are good advisors. You learn about scholarships. The student postgrad organizations are really useful educationally. So you may feel like you know it all, but then share it with other people. And finally, it doesn't matter whether you're in a small or a large institution, in business, government, education, international organizations, you need to understand the system and the structure and how you get things done. Now, this is a secret. If you report to somebody and they don't respond, you do it 3 times, and then you send a copy of that letter to their boss. Because eventually, they should be responding, and they may have to go talk it to write it with their boss. But if you're not getting satisfaction, the proper administration way is go through your boss first, and then their boss. So there's no single way. There are multiple models, and each of you are individuals and unique. And so you're going to find your own ways to do things. And this is only stuff I've learned over 45 years. So what about your training? You are here, but you may be thinking about a postdoc or some other kind of a place. And you want a place, choose a place you'll enjoy. You need to go visit it, meet the people, make sure that you'll enjoy them, that you'll like working with them, that you have things in common. And then check out the opportunities, because there are always fellowships, grants, scholarships, all kinds of things. But remain flexible. Keep your options open. And you want to think about developing a special expertise. In other words, there's something you know a lot about, either something you've worked on or something you want to work on. And that you read, when you read Science and Nature, you read the articles on that, because that allows you to learn about what's going on. But there is truly a role for serendipity. In other words, finding something good without looking for it. So don't make your minds up. Always keep a little bit of open. But of course, you do eventually have to make a decision. Well, what about fellowship applications? So what do? Well, you do your homework. And in this day and age, going to the web and trolling and talking to as many people as you can to find out what's available, what's a good place, how many applications. Sometimes you know you've been assured you'll be accepted. You want to have a backup. So wherever you're going to look for fellowships, for postdocs, think about your backup and how to be sure that you haven't closed any options. But think about what's most important to you. Is it that you work with this person? Is it that you work on this project? Is it that you stay in Vancouver? Think about what your number one priority is this time in your life, and then work around that. So most of the time, you will have an interview, and they'll ask you a bunch of questions, and you should practice for that. You should think of all the bad questions they'll ask and have an answer. But you should be interviewing them, because it's the place you're looking at. So in general, you kind of go in there quaking because you really wanted to do this. You should ask some good questions, and let me tell you, that makes you a good candidate if you ask good questions about what the program's like, about what their opportunities are, and how things usually work for a trainee. So during your training, I'm sure you all get this, you want a didactic component. In other words, there's certain topics that you want to be sure get covered. And as students, you can either organize, or as trainees, you can organize conferences, you can organize sessions, but you want to be sure that you cover a certain number of topics. And as you've been researching all of this, then you'll figure out the things you really want to know about. And there are multiple mechanisms. In medicine, we have what are called rounds, where we go around from patient to patient. There are journal clubs. We have what are called unknown sessions. That is where we bring a weird and wonderful unknown. And then people with experience put in their two cents about how to deal with it. You want lab rotations, as many as you can get so you know how it works so you may not have to do it in the future. Or if you're a lab person, you want as many as possible so you gain experience. But I can tell you for sure, you learn the most from the other trainees. It's quite wonderful because they all have their own interest and experience and expertise. So having coffee, which I know you just come from, having sections where you're actually, you know, informal kinds of situations where you can ask questions. In your place, I guess it would be applied. For us, it's like, how do you have these exposures to different kinds of patients? For you, I guess it's exposures to different ecosystems, different fisheries models. You want to be sure that you've been exposed to those things so you really know what the problems are. How many years? I mean, there are people that never grow up, they keep having postdocs. So there's no easy answer to that, and it's very much framed by your personal and your family situation. I don't know whether you guys have to get a license or maybe pass some boards, or my impression is that when you've just been in training, you are so much more likely to pass whatever those are. Take as many exams as are available in the U.S., in Europe, whatever, because it's the one time you're really prepared. Okay, what about a mentor? There weren't such things back in the dark ages, but you did have people that you were working with, and there are different mentors for different things for different times in your life. And I personally think you don't want just one mentor. You want multiple people that you check in with. And you may admire the way this person has a work-life balance, this person publishes, this person gets grants. You actually want a whole bunch of different mentors. Now, I can tell you that as an elder, it's flattering to be asked for my brilliant advice. But honestly, I want to know what happens. I want to know if it was good advice or bad advice. And I'm interested. If you bother to ask me, I'm interested in what happens. So have the courtesy to thank you and feedback and potentially keep in touch, because then there's another connection can be made with another connection. So the feedback goes both ways. It's important to thank, even if you do the exact opposite. Then I learned that, well, that wasn't a good choice for you. Mentors have multiple jobs, and again, back in the dark ages, none of this was defined. But for sure, your mentor should be asking you to send in abstracts for meetings, so you get the experience of writing that up. They should be asking you to compete for prizes. It's glory on them, but it's important for your CV that while you were in training, you were doing these cool things. It's important they ask you to go to meetings and help you find funding to go to meetings, because when you go to those meetings, you learn about what the real world is about. And at most of the meetings these days, there are both people in business and government that are there, and you can talk to them about what their lives are like. It is extremely important if you have a slightest dream of going into academia to write papers, because your progress is judged by whether or not you write papers. And think about it this way, that in the old days, when there were different kinds of jobs, you apprenticed to somebody, because you watched them work. And so apprenticing to your mentor is something that kind of makes sense, that you want to actually understand their everyday life. Some parts of it you will not want, but some parts of it you'll greatly admire. And so your mentor is actually teaching you how to function. You have to have submitted some abstracts, so you've got something on your CV. You want to have some presentations you've made that's on your CV, so that who's ever thinking about hiring you says, oh, this person knows what they're doing. You want to learn how to make posters. They're very different from actually giving a talk. Mm-hmm. And you want to get some publications. They're not probably going to be on Cell or Nature, for another 15 years, but she wants some publications in your discipline, in respectable journals. You may have to ask. Again, back in my day, I didn't know enough to ask for the Pulitzer Prize for the best oral presentation. But again, if you're thinking in terms of your CV on which you may be hired, it looks really good. And it's perfectly fine that there are poster in fisheries and you get the award for the best poster in fisheries. It's important for you to work your way through that process. Okay, how about establishing yourself? Well, obviously you're looking for where to go and what to do and how to choose that new job. And again, what I would say, really importantly, is you want to be a place where you're going to enjoy it. So, you have to figure out how much you need to cover. Are there labs or teaching assignments or other research? So now you're either a lecturer or an assistant professor. How much are you expected to do? And you've got to be realistic and you've got to look at the people that you've worked with here and figure out, well, how do they balance all those things? In medicine, if you get assigned too many clinics, you have no time to do anything else. If you get assigned too many lectures, you don't have any time to do anything else. And so finding, at this new place, a balance that's realistic is really a good question to ask. They will think you are not naive if you ask that question. So you want to choose a place where there are already other people with whom you will enjoy working. And part of that you may know from out there, but part of it you may learn when you go to visit. And when you go to visit, remember you're interviewing them. I remember feeling like very intimidated that they're interviewing me, but and so I don't think at this stage I was wise enough to say, I'm interviewing them to find out how the world works. Who should be your references? So they will expect that you come to know more than one person, and what you want to do is think about different parts of your abilities. So for instance, maybe the dean knows you were organizing all kinds of student things. Maybe somebody in another department knows how generous you were at helping them. Think about the different references. Obviously, in your specialty, from your mentor, you have to have a very strong reputation. Now you need to get yourself prepared. So as you go around looking for jobs, you're gonna be asked to give seminars, and you're going to have your CV in order, so you need to get ready to give a presentation on your work. You want to, if you're on an academic track, you want to get an academic appointment. There are two ways that's done. One's called grant tenure, where you're on tenure track, but you have to raise your money, and then there are tenure slots. At this time in history, there are very few of those. And so UBC has got major debt problems, and you have to be realistic, but going on what's called grant tenure, which means that you raise some of the money for your salary, is not bad, it's just you want to work yourself out of that. And then you want to ask when you go to get your academic thing, you want to, whether it's in business or government or any place, you want to understand what the steps to promotion are. So what is it that it takes to get promoted? And whatever other things there are. So for instance, in business, they've got money to send you places. Government has some, but only maybe two a year. So you ask about those things. So of course you ask about the salary, but it is not the first thing you ask. And you want it to be competitive with other places. You're not naive. You know what people are paid. And how long is it guaranteed? So usually 3 to 5 years. So that you can get yourself established, which means you need a running start. Space, office, lab, you gotta get that in writing. I can tell you, as an administrator, you need it in writing. So when you go home, you write a letter to whoever invited you to come visit and say, this is my understanding of what we discussed. And then you put it in writing, and they've got it in their emails, even if they delete it, it's there. So you need to confirm the things that you've discussed. What other kinds of resources are available? Parking, forget it. IT should be, a library, travel, laboratory costs maybe as you start up, or if you have to send things off-site, but they're part of your starting up. I mean, there are a whole list of things. And think about them and ask about them. Be nice, but ask about them. What are the teaching responsibilities and opportunities? Because you want access to students, because they're the people that are going to come in and work with you. And so what are the teaching responsibilities, which you want some of, but not too many, access to students and interaction with other faculty, maybe in other departments, and learn how the system works. So you want to have reasonable expectations for all these things, but you also want to know how they're going to be measured once you're there. In other words, if they tell you you have to write 2 papers a year and get at least 1 grant a year, can it be a $3,000 grant? So how will your success and potential promotion be, in fact, valued? So the first year that you're there, or maybe even before you go, you want to be thinking about grants. You want to prepare some lectures in different areas of things you know about. You want to be thinking about the productivity that you're going to produce each year. And you want to think about other kinds of contributions, other areas where you can make contributions. So learn the system at your new place, because it won't be the same as UBC. You want visibility. In other words, you want to give a seminar. You want people to know what you're interested in, so when they run across things, they'll give them to you. And you want to be teaching students because you want interaction and potentially for them to work for you. Committees. I have much to say about committees, but you want to be on committees. Not too many, not ones that take a lot of time. I'll come to that. What other kinds of presentations? Well, national meetings, regional meetings. You want the opportunities for people to see what you're working on, because then they ask you cool questions and they send you opportunities. So what are the ways in your specialty to be recognized that are, so to speak, acceptable? So, about committees. As you establish yourself, you want to be on 3 committees. You've come to your new startup job. You want one related to your professional group. In other words, I would guess there must be fisheries of BC and fisheries of Canada and whatever in your professional group. You want to be one here or there at the institution. Now, they love putting you on acceptance committees, which eats up all of your time. But there are other kinds of committees, like ethics and grant reviews, and there are tons of committees. You want one at your institution so you learn how your institution works. And you want one in the community you're settling in. The community center, Vancouver Institute. I mean, there are many, many ways. But you need to be on them to learn about things and to meet other people. But my rule of 3 is only 3 related to your profession or to your institution or community. You stay on them for 3 years, or you move on to another one so you can learn about a bunch of other stuff. You only become chair if there's something you really want to do. They're always looking for a chair because somebody's got to do it. You only become chair if there's something you want to accomplish. But rotating around, finding new areas, means that you learn about what's going around. So if you're establishing yourself in academia, then you must be furthering knowledge and demonstrating excellence in teaching. You have to do that. There are lots of other things, but you have to do that. If you're establishing yourself in business, you have to fit into the business strategic plan. It's all measured by their strategic plan. And you have to be able to measure your success so you know that you're working. If you're in government, you have to know the guidelines, the laws, and the priorities of a particular government, what is their responsibility, and set goals for how you'll be measured. And you work that out with your boss when you arrive. If you're working at government, you also have to identify your constituency. So for instance, in fisheries, my guess is some of that's First Nations, some of it's whatever you call the Office of Fisheries federally. You have to know who people are. So they've always said the academic stool, that is, if you're working in a university, has three legs, and you need to be engaged in all of them. You need to provide service, you need to give education, and you have to do research. But I want to be sure to have the fourth stool, which I learned the hard way. Administration, good administrators are incredible. They're fantastic. It doesn't come naturally to everybody. But all four of these areas can have research as part of them. Is this a better way to deal with your division heads? And have publications. So there are very specifically academic administrative journals. And as you're starting to set up whatever it is, thinking about doing projects that give you new ways of doing things. So my rule of four is that if you're on the academic track, if you publish four papers a year, you cannot not be published. So everybody talks about publish your peers, but actually you want to do this stuff. You want one paper with a student. You're helping them learn about some kind of fish, I don't know. But you have a student who's really interested in doing this, and you've got some weird thing to report. You want to work with a fellow so that they learn a topic. They review the literature or a series or whatever. Like, you're not even doing the work here, they're doing it. And you get your red pen out. You want to have your own research. So you should be publishing a paper a year on your own research. And then a collaboration with somebody else. So if you're not a lab person, it's with a lab person. If you're somebody else, maybe another department, but they're publishing first author, but you helped them and you did a lot of work and you get credit. If you publish four papers a year, you can not be published. So, to do that, you need a list of possible and ongoing projects. In other words, you need to be thinking into the future. You've got two or three things you're working on. Hopefully, at least one will come to fruition each year. But you redo your list every year. And part of it's you've gone to a seminar and you just think that's the coolest thing. And part of it is that you met this amazing person you want to work with. You have a list of things you are doing and you want to do, and you redo it every year. So once a year, take a day. It can be your birthday, it can be New Year's, it can be Labor Day. Take a day and update your CV. Be sure you've got all the things you've actually done. Make a list of the projects you're working on and set goals. Review what your goals were for last year. You will have accomplished half of them, and the other half you can't stand anymore. So you set up a new list. But at that time, you report to your boss, and you tell them what you've done. They are too busy to keep track of you. So you need to sit down with them, ask to meet with them, and tell them what you're doing. And this is what you're going to try and do next year. And maybe their boss. I mean, it depends on the structure and the system and who's responsible for you. But doing this once a year is like being a grown-up. You really have to do it. Now, to get promoted in academia, and this, I think, is related to all four of the areas, you should list your accomplishments each year. So what have you been doing in teaching? Because you want teaching critiques that get passed on to the promotion committee. An assistant professor needs 5 to 10 peer-reviewed articles, chapters don't count, and needs to present at a national meeting. The more the better. An associate professor, I've been on these committees, and they never let you say how many. This is how many. 20 to 25 peer-reviewed papers. You are accepted in an honorary group, like you're the up-and-coming Fisher. And you've presented at international meetings. And to be a full professor, we're talking about 60 to 70 peer-reviewed original research papers, 20 of which you're the first author, because by then, you're supposed to be letting other people be first authors. And you aren't known in the profession. So when somebody from wherever comes, they ask, do you know this person? The answer is supposed to be yes. So you're known in the profession. Nobody tells you this. It might not be like this in fisheries, but I bet it is. So now we're moving into the next phase where you've already engaged in the profession, the community, and the institution. And now you're at the stage where you are so experienced that you are now going to be a mentor, take on complex problems, horrible situations, but find a really good solution. You are willing to do some administration because it's the way you get things done. And you're using all your experience to be able to innovate, to change, make things be of a different kind. So I just want to, in passing, again say, get involved in your community. You'll meet wonderful people. Rashid and I live next door to each other. We met each other. You can't help but talk about what's going on. In our faculty staff complex, there are people in all dimensions of the university. You go ask them how stuff works. Community club. I mean, if you've got kids and you want to use the exercise room and, but then give some back to it. Your kids' school, if you have kids, or if you're into the community in any way, in sports, being a referee. There are all sorts of organizations. Here in Vancouver, there's Vancouver Foundation, Vancouver Institute, the YWCA, the YMCA. I mean, they're wonderful organizations where you will meet people that you wouldn't meet on campus. And then, of course, there are religious and intellectual and meetups. My daughter goes to meetups. She meets the most interesting people in the community that she would never meet from her job or her position. Maybe you're a dancer in there, dance practice. Maybe you're a singer and you can join a choir. Be sure that you engage in your community. Okay, so looking for the future. And change is inevitable. It's a cool word because it's a verb, a noun, and an adjective. And change is inevitable. When I grew up, I thought you'd get grown up. And it was all done. You get to, and that's the reason for at least 5 different areas during your career. It's as inevitable as can be. Of course, you guys went around before IT, but for some of us, this is like you. It's part of being a living organism that things change. And in every specialty, things will change enormously over your career. When I started medical school, the dean said, only 10% of what you learn over the next 4 years will be true in 10 years. But we don't know which 10% it is. So you've got to learn it all, pass the exams. And part of it is to know which pieces are still true or which aren't, because it will change. And change presents many opportunities, but of course, lots of challenges as well, because you have to look at this change and say, okay, what's good? I read a wonderful book by Mayor Catherine Bateson, who is Margaret Mead's daughter, about composing a life. And basically she said, you've got to be extemporaneous all the time. You've got to continually redefine. That's that once a year, sit down and think about it. There, you can expect things to discontinue. Not that you'll lose your job, but that you won't get a grant or anyhow. But the real challenge is to make that change meaningful. So, get a life. This is what everybody talks about now in terms of life-work balance. And keep it. But re-examine it regularly and try out new things. But be sure that your whole life is not just university and work. And it takes fire in your belly. You have to keep saying, oh, this is so interesting. I think I'll try that. To keep going and to balance. Be sure that you take time off for yourself. Mary Bateson suggests 1 hour a week. And this is sort of out of school to tell you, but she talks about going to church. So her daughter will go to Sunday school, and she can just sit in the audience and think. Take 1 day a week on a trip. You're so busy. You've got to get back, and your experiment's going on. Take a day on a trip to see that city. One of the joys about being academic is you do get to travel. And not to take advantage of that is dumb.
I'm dumb.
Say, take 1 month a year. That's called holiday, vacation, respite. Take it and reflect during it. Don't take your phone with you. Take the opportunity to actually think about, well, okay, how's it all going? And what you'll find is it allows you to actually relax, and then the next morning you wake up with brilliant new ideas. Sabbaticals are part of academia. They kind of have been lost in the pressure of the present time. But sabbaticals, the Sabbath, every 7 years, is part of a long-standing history of academia. And basically, it has to do with taking a chance to seriously reflect. I have had 3 sabbaticals, and I had to work like crazy to get them to happen. And they changed everything. I just urge you to think about a sabbatical. The Sabbath 7, every 7 years, every single cell, a molecule in your body turns over. Not the cells stay, but the molecules turn over. Do you think you're the same person? I don't think so. So, sabbaticals are a time to think, get rid of all your regular routine duties, expose yourself to new ideas. You want to go someplace where you can do that. New routines, new ways of thinking. If you're academic, you go to business. If you're business, you go to academic, you go to government. You basically put yourself in a different situation. And you don't have specific tasks or timetables that you have to accomplish. You go away for at least the first month. I mean, you may have kids in school, so you can't be permanently. But you have to get rid of everything. You really have to get rid of things. It takes at least 2 years to plan for it. And for the first, when I went to Oxford on my second sabbatical, I realized I was still dreaming about things back in Vancouver. Ah! So it takes 3 months to stop thinking and to actually loosen up your brain in a way that lets you do things. Now, I want to say something about science, and part of this is an introduction to women in science. So the essence of science is that you really have to ask the right questions, which can lead to changes in understanding. And part of that is to challenge old ways of thinking in relevant new ways, using often new technologies. But it can really be applied to business and government. And whatever your relationships with the people there are, it can really help. So I'm a clinician, that means I deal with people. And in medicine, if you're a clinician, you're diagnosing. In other words, it's not hypothesis driven, it's diagnosing. On the basis of what is known, it's applied, it's bedside, it's with patients, and you're dealing with human beings. Researchers are in the world of science, and they're scientists, and they do hypothesis driven research on what is not known. It's theoretical, but it can also be bench and applied. And we're talking about cells and molecules and animals, I think, in our case. So what about women? Rashid already said there were only 3 women in my class in medical school, among 75. Well, they didn't know what to do with us. They stuffed us in the dental technician's locker room because they didn't know what to do with us. Things have definitively changed, and I can speak for medicine, but you probably know as much about women in science. It's probably now about 50%. But the leadership roles are still occupied by men. And I do think that men function on a different way of doing things. Things have really changed over time. Again, I have medical stuff. And in terms of full professor, it's about 15%. It hasn't reached the level yet. It depends on the specialty, and my guess is it depends in other areas of science that women are drawn to certain areas. But secular work has been built on a male model. It's competitive, hierarchical, all-consuming, and you've got somebody at home to take care of things. But the times are changing, and real people have real lives and want to engage, and it's complex. So I do want to say that I think women's approach to science is different. It's complementary, and it's an opportunity to do some of these things, because women tend to be collaborative. They tend to be multidisciplined. They form networks. They mentor and nurture kind of naturally. They care about the socialization, and they care about the ethics of what's going on. They use different language, and they can be misunderstood. But the subjective, holistic approach is actually a very important one to keep in mind. But the subjects and the topics that they choose to do their research on are not the prime vehicle ones. And our national agencies have started to look at this because they realize it's really true. And they care about the working training environment. So, stress. You are choosing a stressful career if you go into academia. It actually builds resiliency. So the fact there's some stress, but it's kind of keeping it in control. And you unequivocally learn from your mistakes. So when you make a mistake, instead of trying to cover it up, think about what you have learned and move on. Challenges are actually invigorating. They inspire you to do stuff. Now this is my five goods, which come from when I was in medical school. There was a woman who was a professor of pathology who had a family and managed to juggle everything, and she would meet once a month with the women. It was incredible. You felt like you were a real person and it might be possible. And she said there are five goods. If you're going to succeed with a professional life, you have to be organized. She had endless lists that she kept track of all the things she had to buy, all the things she had to do at home, all her kids. You've got to be organized. You need good help. You cannot do it all. I had a live-in housekeeper when my kids were little. There was just no way, any other way. You can't go home and have another full-time job. So you need good help, whether you are male or female. You need friends and good partners who actually support you, aren't competing with you. They want to see you succeed. You need good health. This is stressful, and you need to take care of your health. And she said, you need good luck. Now, I actually don't think it's luck. I think it's good fortune, because you work your butt off. If you're an academic, you work. But you need your work to work. So, becoming a professional. When does it happen? When do you know you're grown up? Well, it happens at different times for different people. And there's a whole literature on how your brain works, where part of it's working on your science and your professional stuff, and another part of your work is absorbing and knowledge and caring. So the thing is, you don't want those two to be separate. You actually want integration of the various parts of your work. Okay, so now we're talking about winding down. I already said this when I was born, and there are 30 extra years that nobody had before. So, it's way too early for many of you, but what about retirement? Well, you have to have some money put away. You need to invest. About a third of people retire like our parents did, and we've actually done studies now. My parents did, which is they stopped work, they moved south, and they took up new things. They invested in their families and their community. But of today's academics, about a third keep doing just what they were doing but not being paid. And they love it, and they're very proud of the work they're doing. And a third take their skills and use them in some other way. Teaching in a third world country, becoming a consultant, starting a business, myriad of opportunities of things you can do with the academic fisheries experience that you have. But you kind of need to start thinking about it. So again, in medicine, what we know is many more men continue to work past 65 than women. Whatever the case, we as a society need to find a way that we use the latter part of people's lives and experiences. It's a total waste to hang them out. So, and they lived happily ever after, except for that age thing. It is true. There are these age things where you get a little creepy, and you take longer to do things. When I became chair of pediatrics, there were five people that had to retire that year, and they were mad at me. Pardon me. Since you started at UBC, you knew you had to retire at 65, and you're mad at me? Like, what is the problem? Anyhow, I met with all of them. And one said, I have 35 papers to write. Do you think the department could do the last version? This was before computers and typing was okay. He wrote 32 papers. Incredible. So he had to organize what he wanted to do, and it worked. One had been the chair before the previous chair. And he hung around and hung around. I thought he'd drive me crazy. And he was just being a good guy. He just wanted to help me because I didn't know what was going on. Well, I finally said to him after a while, why don't you write this to the department? Because you've been here since the very beginning. He went away for 3 years and wrote the most magnificent history of the department with all the personalities of people. It was fantastic. But the other three went away hurt. And I decided that was really horrible that the university and the Children's Hospital should appreciate them, and it shouldn't be like that. So what I ended up doing was thinking a lot about how work-life changes, what's required in terms of flexibility and creativity on the basis of things, and what do one need? Do you really need to be paid if you plan accordingly? Absolutely, you need to plan financially. But maybe there should be a new tax incentive, something the university can do. And so in terms of, again, I know this is early for many of you, but you need to start planning when you're about 55, and there might be a few of you that need to start planning. You need to have saved enough money to support a longer lifespan. And you need to find your replacement. So in those last 10, 15 years, ensure there are young people coming along that can do the things that you've done, are trained. A lot of stuff really does change. Your social context, you're not coming in to work every day. Your health changes, and there are some specific ailments of adults that you might be able to prevent. There's lots of maintenance. Memory is different. It takes you sometimes an hour to think of that person's name. And that doesn't mean you're getting Alzheimer's, it's just how your memory works. But you do need to plan, think about volunteer work, ask the question, do you need to be paid? Hopefully you can do what you want to do. And lots of things change, like the clothes you need, and the schedule, and the IT you need. So this is my favorite. No, Grandma. Double click the internet. Explorer icon. This is truly me. So again, just kind of to put it in perspective, as you're going through your career, think of it in decades, and things that happen in decades, and how you can look forward and think about what might happen in the future, and really begin to think about it. And again, if you're interested at all, this is the paper I ended up writing, showing to Rashid, in terms of reflections on an academic career. If you do bother to read it, or anything you've heard today, I'd love feedback, because as far as I can see, there's nothing else out there at all about these different stages, and how you change during the course of it, and what the expectations are. So if it doesn't fit for fisheries, let me know. But if you find it useful, I'm really interested in additional thoughts that you have. So thinking about an academic career, for those of you who are thinking about it, or those of you who are in it, you gotta keep thinking about it. Stop once a year and do your reflecting. Take your sabbaticals. Enjoy the wonderful aspects of getting to be in academia. Thank you.
That was amazing. Thank you so much. We need more talks like this, I think. I struggle a lot. I mean, I'm in my master's, so it's early days, but I struggle with, because of all the competition, I try and make myself competitive by, and also trying to stay sane by doing things outside of school. So I teach on the side, and I've been volunteering a lot in my master's, but it also means that I don't have as much time, and I get burnt out, and then I'm like, what am I doing? I should quit everything and just do my master's. And I'm wondering what your opinion is on that.
So I don't say do like I did, because my life was, being a woman in medicine in those days, the way I looked at it was I had to be incredibly prepared, because otherwise I would reflect on they shouldn't let any more women into medical school. So I did actually bend over backwards to be sure that I was prepared. And I think that's the best I can say, is you have to take time. I mean, maybe one way to do it is to say 7 hours a week, you know, some limit. But you also have to take care of your health. And burnout is not fun. It may make you a little bit more resilient, but it's not fun. So I urge all of you to have outside things, but you have to limit them too. So I think you're saying you might be at the stage where you need that day to go reflect and think about.
Yeah, it's hard.
When I deal with families who have children who have all kinds of handicaps, I say, you have to go away once a year and think about your average normal children as well. Because they need your attention and they're feeling neglected. So there's part of you that's feeling neglected, I can tell. And I don't think, it's so individual, it's so this year versus next year. Mm-hmm. It's extemporaneous, and it really is. Yeah. Sorry to not be more specific.